I would like people to remember me by as being that sarcastic but sincere guy who really cared about people and just wanted to have a good time too.
Which at times was bad, made me hate running, made me want to quit every day. and I'd cry before almost every meeting, him dragging me out the door saying we had to go. But if he didn't do that, I wouldn't be where I am, you know, now running in college and actually enjoying it and stuff. So it definitely helped out that he was my dad and my coach at the same time.
Well, in the beginning, it was great because I was able to stay home with the children. He also did a lot of tutoring, which allowed me to stay home as well. I think it worked out really well for our family. It made him very compassionate for our children and raising our children and spending time with our children. And we got to have the summers off, and we did a lot with kids during the summer.
I definitely think that me and my dad are the most similar out of everyone in our family, which means he's very sensitive and very caring, and he understands me a lot when no one else in the family does.
I don't remember having any problems with him in school.
So with him, he would, no matter what you want, what time you want, anything, like, he would drop everything that he's doing and do it for you. And in, like, along those lines, if, like, something gets messed up, like, either your phone battery's dead or we didn't record anything on the TV, like, he will call the company, no matter what time, and at the end of, like, he'll end up getting, like, something for free. Like, I think my phone battery was, like, messed up where it only went to 80%, so he called Apple and ends up getting a $500 gift card to spend on anything he wanted. Like, that was from the Apple store, so that was pretty cool.
I think the major thing is that he's selfless. Mm-hmm. You know, everyone comes first, whether it's his students, his, you know, his, the guys he coaches, his family, his, whether it's his mother, his sisters, his brothers, you know, and absolutely all of us, all come first, and eventually he'll, you know, do things for himself.
I remember his friends. They all lived pretty close, you know, in the neighborhood. Jay and Paul.
He definitely tries to connect with us each in our own special way. Like he knows I really love Broadway, so me and him try to see as many shows as we can, and he, like, you would track.
Yeah. And running.
Yeah.
And track.
Yeah.
And more running.
Yeah. Kind of like to run.
Yeah. I mean, it's also good in that sense because he, like, if I'm hurt or, like, if anything, like, he'll come with me to the doctor. Like, he knows what to tell them. He knows, like, how to, like, get across in ways that mom wouldn't know because she lacks that kind of expertise with the whole running and that kind of lifestyle.
Yeah, she definitely lacks expertise in Broadway, too.
Yeah. So yeah, those things definitely.
I think he had a good relationship with his sisters and his little brother. Maybe there were conflicts with his older brother, but I think that's kind of normal when you have older and someone who's quite close to older.
So something we both have definitely noticed about our dad and realized was actually seen through the way he, like, treats the track team and works with them, both the guys and the girls.
And talks about them.
Yeah, and talks about them at home.
He natters and natters and natters away at you until you finally say, I give up, you win. That's, sounds bad, but it's his determination. I can't say anything bad about it. Drives you crazy.
I think he's very compassionate and he seems very fair. I think he loves working with the guys and the whole coaching, running community. He's met a lot of people through the community. We've met other families through the community. We spent a lot of time with other coaches and their families. We've rented cabanas with them. So he's very compassionate and he's, you know, understands the guys. He loves working with them. I don't think he can ever give it up, even when he does retire. I think track has been his life. He's, you know, helped our kids through a lot of different activities, you know, with the coaching, and it's made Ed who he is now.
To say one proudest, he graduated from high school, he graduated from college, he got a good job right away out of college. his babies, his marriage. Did I mention that? And I've always been very proud of him.
As now everyone knows that I do track, he's my coach. So just I feel like that as a whole is just one way that like the most you can be supportively like to one of your kids is being a coach. Because you have to support them while they're in their like sport competition, whatever you want to call it. And then like when they come home and they're upset about like whether they didn't like run well or play well. So he's definitely supportive by being able to handle both sides of that kind of mentality and stuff.
Definitely this semester at college was probably one of the hardest for me. And one thing I learned this year is that whenever something bad happens to you, Dad will tell you all the bad things that happened to him.
You know, he's always puts us first as a family. He's always wants to make sure I'm happy. You know, he did allow me to stay home with the children for 10 years. And then when I did want to go back to school and get my master's, he had no problem with going along with that. So he's a pretty giving person.
Also, I think the thing that we hate the most, but also shows like how much he cares about us, is that whenever we fight or anything, something's happening, he always says, "I just want you guys to be happy. I just want you guys to be happy." And
which, ironically, just ends up making us more mad.
Yeah.
But at least he's trying.
Yeah.
So.
It shows like that he, like, that's really what he wants. He just wants everyone to stop fighting, stop worrying about anything, and just, like, be happy.
Some stories about Ed. I'm sure there are plenty of stories that I could tell, but I probably should do it on this video. I think a lot of it is he constantly wanted to keep us all active, whether it was camping, kayaking, you know, down at the beach. He always had us all doing something the summers, you know, whether it's, you know, the days camping. And, you know, I remember one time camping when the children were little and we were in a double tent and it poured. And so, and it was a little cold, and I think Megan may have been 3 months old. So we took Michael's tube socks and we put them on her hands, and the camping site got smaller and smaller. Well, I should say the dry tent got smaller and smaller. But, you know, Ed got up the next morning, everything was hung up and everything dried out, and we just kept on camping for the weekend, even though it poured. But there are some, like, funny stories like that that we could tell. Whether, and also, you know, the holidays for Christmas, he had to have so many gifts for the kids to open. Whether it's just toothbrushes, whether it's, you know, anything small, the more the kids opened, the more excited that they got. So he was always thinking with things like that with the kids. And, you know, he always had to do things in a big way to get the kids all excited. So I don't know who was more excited when Christmas morning came along, whether it was Ed or the children, because he just loved to see the faces on them.
Everything's good for them, and like it's everything's right. So it made us realize how much work he puts into us, and how much he actually cares about us.
We realized that the track team is his
second family.
And being able to go or like visit some of like the trips they go on shows like how much fun they have, which makes us have fun with them.
Yeah, and it's also cool that like we were able to become like friends with
a lot of the track kids.
Which is kind of weird, because like if we think like being friends with like our track coaches' kids, like it's like crazy, but it just seems so normal.
Yeah, it's always weird to think like reversed. If Dad was like, if we were the kids and Dad was our coach, it'd be weird. But like, but for the North
it
Shore,
it just seems so natural.
Yeah, exactly.
So when Kim talked to him to go to school, college, he wanted to go to the better school. And we were up practically all night discussing why he couldn't go to Maryland. It was either he go to Maryland and we not eat, or he goes to a lesser school. He ended up at Temple. He was there, I don't know how long he was there for, but he disappeared one weekend. And nobody knew where he was. Apparently he had gone to Maryland, and he wasn't registered in Maryland. So I don't know what the story was. When he got back to Temple, his father went up and said, you're going to a state school, and Oswego was the school that was decided on.
I think his compassion, his, you know, giving everything he's got to whatever he does, I think that his life revolves around his three children, and he loves giving back to the guys, the students that he teaches, he coaches, as well as, you know, his friends' kids, and I think it's the way he just relates to people in general, and he always wants to keep everybody active, he always wants to be fair, he always wants to include everybody, he never wants to, you know, leave anyone out. He's just, he's a very giving person. Like, dinner, he, like, brings up what Jack is doing. He's like, oh, Jack's going to Nationals this year. All this stuff about Jack. And,
it's all about Jack, always.
It's always about Jack. Always about Jack. He talks about Jack more than he talks about Michael. So, yeah.
You're like, Jack's not your buddy? No, that's just...
Yes, honestly. But anyway.
When we were going across country, we went from New York to Oregon, because that's where my mother and father lived, in Oregon. So when we were driving and we were going higher altitude, he started complaining about his ears. His ears hurt. All he had to do was pop them. Everybody else was fine, but he was in the back seat complaining for God knows how long how his ears hurt. Another story is when we got to Oregon, my father made arrangements for them to go out on a boat in the Pacific Ocean fishing. And he was the only one that caught the fish. And this is how he caught the fish. Over the side of the boat, getting sick, but the fish kept going to his line.
So we've noticed that he puts all of his time into them and a lot of his time into them, and he works so hard with, like, making sure that they know, like...
No, he doesn't natter at me like he did. We're good.
So one story I have that sticks out in my mind, it's not like the best story, but, you know, it's something that stayed with me, was junior year at the division meet. All I remember is that my coach was standing on one side of the track, my dad was standing on the other side of the track, and they were both just yelling at me about stuff to do, and I completely disregarded what my coach was saying and listened to only what my dad was saying, and then ended up running one of, like, the best races of my life. So I don't know why, but that sticks out in my mind that he was, because I relate that to him always being there for me and stuff during, like, at track meets, whether it's actually track related or not track related, he was just always there.
You don't have to. If you want to, you can, but you don't have to.
You don't have to.
I think the one thing that always sticks out in my mind when I think of Dad is the day that me, Mom, and Dad found out that I was sick. I remember when they told me, my dad started crying, and it was the first time I've ever seen him cry. And it's like, whenever you see your parents cry, it, like, hits you, it's like,
wow.
Yeah, you always view them as a superhero, someone who doesn't really feel anything, but they're human, and they're your parents, and... Like, that just shows you, like, their love for you.
I think the major thing I'd like to share is that, you know, Ed tried not to separate his work, his coaching, and his family. He brought us all together. There's many times that we, as a family, have spent time up at North Shore, whether it's cooking in the kitchen or the girls helping with, you know, with hurdles or... just hanging out with the friends. Our children have become good friends with a lot of the children up at North Shore. So I think he really did a good job at bringing his social life and his work life together and made it all work really well. Yeah, like, we definitely think our dad's a hard worker. And I said before, like, he would do anything for anyone.
Especially things he's, like, passionate about, like track, yeah. The team, us.
He puts 110% into everything he does.
Yeah.
I met Fast Eddie Corona here when he came from the middle school. He came into our office in the closet, and helped make it a home for us.
Verona entered our previous workspace, the cave closet, and he became a part of our workspace and our family.
So I first met Ed around 12 years ago, I guess, when he transferred to the high school. Don't really remember any specific first encounter, but by the time winter came around, we were doing ski club together and hanging out pretty regularly, and I gotta say, he's one of my best friends here at North Shore. The fastest guy I've ever met in the world. When you wanna talk to Fast Eddie, you've gotta make sure that you pin him down and that you are ready to move as quickly as he does.
My first impressions of Mr. Corona is actually very serious. I watched how he spoke to the boys in the team, and me being a new coach here in the district and him being here for a long time, I was just trying to pick up on his his personality, how he engaged with everyone, just kind of go with that.
So my first impression of Corona, I started freshman year and I was just a sprinter, so I didn't really work with him as much, but I could tell he was kind of a really focused person, and he knew a lot, and he was a wise person, so I was excited to impress him, I guess, at meets and stuff, and kind of get to know him more.
My first impressions of Coach Corona were when he pulled me and some of my friends up from the middle school team in 8th grade in the springtime, and when I first met him, he was very welcoming. He made the transition from being in middle school to high school sports really smooth, and he was really kind to us, and I was very excited to experience what would be the next 5 years of my running career with him.
So when I first met Coach Corona, I was a freshman who just joined the cross country team with really no friends on the team or very few people I knew, and I think it was the first run I ever did with the cross country team was a hippie park with a add-on at North Shore Acres, and I'm running with Corona and the rest of the JV guys, and I'm kind of feeling starting to feel maybe I will be comfortable being on this team, being with everyone here, and I was just trying so hard to keep up with him and try to impress the new coach, and that was pretty tough. And that was probably the hardest run of my life. But then I really met Corona after my first JV race, because I ended up, running something that was a little unexpected. And then afterwards, Corona was, kept finding me in the hallway and talking to me and trying to see, talk to me about my importance on the team. And then I really realized that, this guy, he really cares about the sport. He really wants to win. And, he really has all of the best hopes in mind for me and the athletes.
My relationship with Mr. Corona, it's certainly evolved in the last 15 plus years. We spent so much time together, 3 seasons a year, summers, trips, even at times, vacations. It's really involved to him being, one of the closest people in my professional relationships here in the North Shore schools. And, obviously we've had our ups and downs, but overall, he's one of the closest people in my life.
Beyond colleagues, it's friends. It is mentorship. I kind of think of him as a father figure, a role model of how to live life.
I don't see him just as a colleague. I see him as a friend and part of the family. As I moved into Merrick, he made us part of that community. And I'm very grateful for all his work that he ever did for us.
So my relationship with Corona over my high school career, so like I said, I was a sprinter when I first started, so he didn't really know me that much, but then I moved up to distance, and he still didn't really know me that much, but then I started getting better, and I kind of showed, my persistence and commitment and hard work, and he eventually kind of took notice of me, and then, he started paying more attention to me, and I got better, obviously, and we ended up having a really good relationship, I think. He recognized that I was a hard worker, and he definitely appreciated that.
My relationship with Coach Corona is a pretty intense one. I mean, when we were younger, it was more of a, you know, trying to get me more into the sport, really trying to convince me never to play basketball in my life again. And, you know, he was a kind of, I thought, kind of a character, because when I didn't do cross country, when I stopped doing track and went to track for basketball, he would give me these death stares in the hallway. And then as soon as springtime rolled around, I was back on the track. It was like we were best friends again. So, I mean, the relationship has gone, like, up and down, but it's always been a really strong one. And especially in my senior year, almost every day I was talking to Corona, you know, talking about workouts, about other things, like personal matters. And he's always there for me. He's got this mentality of, you know, wanting to help people. So whenever I'm in trouble or whenever, you know, there's something wrong, I always go and talk to Corona about it, because he's always there for me. And, you know, this was probably one of the strongest relationships I had in high school with a faculty member.
Coach Corona's characteristics that I admired most during my time in high school is that when we weren't performing well in terms of running, he would be really tough but supportive of us, and that would help push us to get better. But when we did have really, like, great shining moments on the track, he was definitely, like, more celebratory.
One characteristic of Corona is that he pushes us not to give up, or he's very supportive. He doesn't want us giving up on one set of the workout, doesn't want us giving up on the race. He just pushes us to our full limits.
His integrity, and in terms of his loyalty, and his always ability to, you know, try to do the right thing. And despite if, you know, things didn't, you know, necessarily go his way, he always tried to do the right thing by others, which I, you know, I really commend.
So the characteristics that stand out the most to me about Corona is he's really focused, he's persistent, and he's not afraid to be tough on his athletes to make sure they're doing the right thing instead of being soft and not really caring.
Corona is just a pretty caring guy, and it doesn't, when you first meet him, at, you know, most people's first impressions of him is that he's kind of like an asshole. A lot of the state meet kids that I always meet, they always complain and ask me, you know, how do you deal with your coach? He's so mean. He's, you know, yelling at me. I'm like, yeah, he comes off as, you know, this kind of aggressive guy, but once you get to know him, he's pretty warm and fuzzy. He really does care about people, and it sometimes takes a different angle to realize that. But, you know, he has the best thoughts for everyone, trying to make sure that everyone reaches their potential and everyone can succeed in the sport, in the classroom, you know, in life in general. So he's always got a positive mindset. He's also, he can get, you know, a little stubborn sometimes, I say, and it's a little bit of a conflicting relationship with us, because I'm pretty stubborn myself. So we both, a lot of times, argue about workouts or, you know, being on time to places. He's one of those guys that really likes everything to be on time, and I'm kind of a more relaxed character, so that's a little bit of conflicting relationships and characteristics. But other than that, you know, he's really got a bunch of things going for him in terms of being caring and positive and trying to help everyone out.
I hope this doesn't come across wrong, but Ed's not the kind of guy who initially comes across as warm and friendly. You really have to spend months or years with Ed in order to get to that side of him. I'm not arguing he's not warm and friendly. He's one of the warmest, friendliest, most loving people that I can imagine meeting. It's just that when he first meets you, I don't know if it's blinders, I don't know if it's a wall, I don't know what it is, but it takes a good long time to get to Fast Eddie. I like to think of myself as a guy who has opened up Fast Eddie's warm personality to a lot of people who initially might not have thought he was, I don't know, as personable and hilarious and warm as we all know him to be.
So the aspects of Corona's coaching that have really helped me and taught me, he's definitely not afraid, like I said, to be tough on his athletes, and he instills the fact that you have to want it yourself. He can't make you want it. It has to come from you, and that's eventually, obviously, how you improve. So he definitely taught me those lessons.
Three words he's always told me: let it go. You know, as everyone knows, I become obsessed if I perseverate on certain things. Maybe I can do well in a race, or someone's upset with me, and he's always just told me to let it go, and things will be okay. And that's one of the things I've always will remember him by.
My favorite memory of Corona is probably my junior year indoor season at the Armory. We had a 4x8 and 4x8 relay, and he wasn't able to make it, but he wanted me to text him what I split. I ended up splitting a really good time. It was a PR. And I remember I was so excited to text him what I ran, and he was so happy, and I knew from that, like, he was really a caring coach, and he cared about his athletes improving. So that's my favorite memory, probably.
Coach Corona was very supportive on the track in high school, off the track in math class, and still very supportive in me. Coach Corona was very supportive of me all throughout my running career. One time in which it definitely helped was during my freshman year, during the winter track season. I had a long stretch of time where I had very bad performances throughout the meets, and Coach Corona was not afraid to let me know that these performances weren't up to standard. And while he at times was a little tough on me, it definitely pushed me to reach my full potential, and if he wasn't as tough as he was at times, it would not have pushed me to push myself to the limits during practice and at meets.
Corona has been definitely almost like a father figure in my life, in terms of especially running with the sport and everything, trying to push me to my limits, trying to teach me that that you could be successful with hard work. And I think he, gave me a really big gift in pushing me to, try the sport out and keep going with it and become, a pretty big athlete in the sport. And I can't thank him enough for all the opportunities that have come from that. One of his biggest aspects that he's taught me is to be competitive. I had kind of a competitive nature, but then with Corona in the mix, everything becomes competitive. Every league meet, every county meet, every state qualifier, every race becomes competitive with him. And all that competitiveness has, driven me to become a better athlete, a better runner, and a better person.
What's your favorite memory of Corona?
Our trips together. All our talks we've had over the years, and just, watching him. He should be a tour guide on the side, just what it's been in Hershey Park or Washington, D.C., or, Myrtle Beach, just to see how, how he... when he's, not stressed out about what's going on in life, he's got many things going on, that just the talks we've had over the years about, whether it's about movies or politics or finances, that I always remember about.
And what will you miss most about him?
I said our talks, we've had ups and downs over the years. He spent so much time with an individual, but just our chats and our talks about, things that are going on, whether it's the track world or, about 403Bs or about, retirement or, FAS or whatever it is. It's just the talks we've had together, just the two of us.
My favorite memory with Coach Corona was my most recent one at the state qualifier meet, which was my last meet on the team. Me, Luke Martin, Aiden Stolberger, and Aiden LaPorin ran the school record for the 4x1, which was 45.50, which is an average of about 11.37 for each 100. I think that was my favorite memory with him, because it was so exciting to see his reaction.
My favorite memory of Coach Corona was definitely going to school and parents' weekend when my parents came the weekend before. He was there and we had a lot of fun, went out to eat, and just spent the whole day together catching up, and him asking me of how I am in school and the big transition.
Favorite memory with Corona has to be that time after I was running the 3200 meter in the spring state meet, and I kind of just fell apart in the last few laps and really had probably one of my first really challenging races in my life. But I expected him to be really angry, but instead he was out there supporting me, telling me that I'm ready for tomorrow, and To me, from that moment on, I realized that, you know, there is a little bit more to the competitive self that Corona is, that he actually, you know, really does care about every one of his athletes. And then he, you know, it's not always about performance, but just your will to, you know, be a better athlete, be a better person, all that stuff.
We were planning a retirement party for Ed that went off in some capacity, but we didn't exactly get to do everything we wanted to do because there was some bad weather that day, so we didn't get to go kayaking with him. The thing is, when you're planning a party for Ed, it is important to stay on your toes and to keep moving, because Ed is the kind of guy that changes the parameters of the plans virtually dozens of times and right up until the event itself. I'm supposed to be meeting Ed to kayak after school tomorrow. For all I know, he could change that to a weekend trip to Montreal. In fact, I hope he does.
The memory I have of Coach Corona that really demonstrates the relationship he had with many of his athletes is during my junior year, we went down to Long Beach, close to where he lives, to do the polar plunge with him in the winter. And that was just a really fun memory I have of us all kind of getting together outside of track and outside of school and doing something that really brought us closer together and showed the closeness that we had, not only on the track.
So over 4 years, I've had many, many countless experiences with Mr. Corona, from all the trips we've taken, all the state meet trips, trips to Penn Relays, trips to Yale, trips to Virginia, trips to Nationals.
One of the fonder memories I have with Coach Corona is during my sophomore year, we had struggled in the 4x800 meter for most of the year and didn't really have any great times. And during the state qualifier, which was our biggest meet of the year, we ran a 7:59, which was a school record. And that was a huge PR and a huge leap from what we had done during the rest of the year. And I remember that even though we didn't end up making it to the state meet, Coach Corona was extremely happy with us, and despite some of us being a little down on ourselves for getting second place, he really emphasized how much of an achievement it was that we ran such a great time, and he was definitely much more positive, which helped us kind of view it in a more positive light.
While we didn't get out as many times this year as we have in years previous, Ed really became a good running buddy of mine, and I really enjoyed our times in the morning banging around the streets of Seacliff before we have to work. Love him on the streets, love him in the locker room. He's just a great guy to run around and listen to.
Another memory that I love looking back on is the time that we presented Corona with a gift of colorblind glasses that basically like fixed his colorblindness, or temporarily, as he had them on at least. This meant a lot to me and to him, of course, because it was something I had always thought of getting him since 8th grade, and to see him put them on for the first time was really interesting, and it really touched my heart that we were able to change something in his life. It was really funny watching him run around the school courtyard looking at all the different flowers and colors, and I loved hearing that at Nationals he was driving around and stopping different places to look at different colors, and I think that's one of my favorite days to look back on, because it was a really great moment that really had nothing to do with track, it just had to do with our bond as a team.
He really likes Steak and Shake, and he really likes Wawa.
I remember a couple of road trips to see away Jets games that I went to with Ed and a bunch of the guys. A trip to Buffalo stands out explicitly, as does a trip to Philadelphia. The Buffalo trip, I remember Eddie was walking around in a Thomas Jones jersey 2 years after Thomas Jones had left the Jets. And I would say he was universally and singularly berated by the vast majority of the fans in the parking lot there at Buffalo. It was a great time. Second row seats in the end zone, saw Braylon Edwards catch a touchdown pass right in front of us, saw LaDainian Tomlinson have a touchdown run. Jets won the game handily for one of the few times I've been there for a Jets win. And I just can't tell you how much fun it was. We started the trip I made everybody listen to The Things They Carry by Tim O'Brien, and I can't say that that went over as well as I'd expected. So the next time I go on a road trip, I'm going to try to find something just a little bit lighter for Ed and the guys.
I do remember the time that me and the guys were late for one of the board meetings, and after the board meeting, he took us outside and really just kind of screamed at us for about 30 minutes.
So another story I have of Corona is the day before we had a 4x8 relay, a last chance to qualify for the Penn Relays. It was kind of a last minute thrown together meet, and Corona knew I was pretty nervous for it, I've been kind of in a slump lately around that time. So the day before, after we finished some strides, I remember he kind of gave me a pep talk, and he knew, like, I had the heart for it, and he knew, he just believed in me. And that really meant a lot, because I knew he really cared, and he was really excited for what we could do, so.
Ed literally has more friends than anybody I know. Whenever he's got a Christmas party, he packs his house full of 50 snowmen and about 100 neighbors. It's a Christmas party we look forward to every year, hanging out in the backyard. He's got a mobile fire pit, and I can't tell you how much Eddie's house just always seems like home. And I get the idea that it's like that for a bunch of people. His kids' graduation parties, Ed shuts down the entire block, literally puts up barricades, wheels in a snow cone making truck, bouncy houses, everything you could possibly imagine, and literally has a carnival up and down Road Ave. It's pretty awesome.
I really remember the day that the other boys ran the 4x8 in under 8 minutes at the state qualifier meet, and it was just such an amazing sight for me as a sophomore. I think I was a freshman, actually. Seeing, this coach be so enthusiastic and so impressed and so joyful that his team just ran a good time. I mean, he was jumping up and down. They didn't win. They lost, but he was still so impressed and so happy and so optimistic about the future and the whole team.
Stories of the leaves changing on the way to Buffalo. Montreal, kayaking, weddings, and just lots of debauchery. Shots in Long Beach.
So another story I have of Coach Corona's, all the guys, we went to his house one day to tear down his old swing set and plant some new grass in his backyard. It was pretty funny. It was kind of like a fun afternoon at his house, and we all kind of bonded, and we had pizza, and it was kind of fun getting with everyone outside of just practice, so it was a good bonding experience.
When the other boys left last year, he mentioned that he kind of felt like he was, a feeling that usually a parent gets is that he was always proud of our program and proud of the boys, and, those things always stick out to me as really keystones to Corona's characteristics, his personality, and his livelihood. That I really enjoy thinking back upon was the time when the cross-country team made it to the state competition up in Rochester, New York. This team had not made it there for a really long time. We had a competitor in our league that moved up the year that everyone was a senior. And we had such a good team put together. We went up there, went to Rochester in the blistering cold on the most torrential course in the history of mankind. It almost looked like World War I out there. But we all ran it. We got muddy, we got dirty, and we put up a great performance and placed, in the top 10 in the state. And just being there with the team, with Corona, it just was really good bonding experience, and it really just showed the heart of the team.
I'm going to talk about a trip to Philadelphia as well. I remember another road trip that we all took to Philadelphia. It started off with a bang. I remember as soon as we left the parking lot, we set an over-under time for arrival. I think we set something like 3 hours, like 7:07. And about 7:06 that night, we were literally racing against the clock and had a really good time just betting on even when we would get to the hotel. Philadelphia was a wild party, to say the least. I remember going to have drinks in a haunted house, and I'm reasonably sure that I've got a picture of Ed passed out with the Book of Mormon. Not sure why.
So my relationship with Corona throughout my high school career, it started, like I said, it started out, I was a sprinter, so I didn't really know him as much, but then I moved up to distance my second year, and I could tell he was just, like, a really focused person, and he really cared about his athletes, and he really was knowledgeable about, like, the workouts and everything. He knew exactly what he was doing. I was really excited to grow and improve under his training, so, I mean, I got to know him better, and we had a good relationship coaching and athlete-wise, and I ended up improving a lot thanks to him, so we ended up having a pretty good relationship.
The memory I have of Coach Corona that really sticks out to me looking back is the last meet of high school for me and my fellow seniors during spring track. After the meet ended, everyone was pretty emotional, including Coach Corona. And he just gathered us together afterwards and reminded us what a special bond we all shared. And it was something that we would never be able to recreate and something we would never forget. And it was just really special that in a pretty emotional moment, he was reminding us of what we should be happy about and everything that we can look back on so fondly in our high school experience.
As being a member of the Nassau County track program and all those other coaches have always come up to me and said, like, oh, I wish I had you on my team, or Mr. Steiner just said, like, you should come to Manhasset. Mr. Levy always talking about how he could be a good coach, a better coach for me. But there's no doubt in my mind that having Coach Corona as my coach throughout high school, I don't think any other coach could have made me a better person, a better athlete, a better individual than he did, and I would never, redo that relationship ever again, because he was just so impactful on my life.
Well, obviously I'm going to miss Ed. He's leaving behind some tremendously large shoes to fill as a friend, as a colleague, and certainly as part of, his retirement party, I said part of the fabric of the school, and he really is part of the fabric of the school. I don't know who we're going to get to replace him in his desk, but it's going to take a long time before anyone replaces him in our thoughts and feelings.
I think he is a person that will never retire, and his legacy will live on. I guarantee when I drive to work at 7:45 in the morning, I'm going to see him running around the neighborhood. He's that type of person. Retirement is too slow for him.
It's going to be sad to see him go, to see him not here every day. However, I do know where he lives, and I plan on having many events. He's always active and moving and on the go, so I know I'm going to be with him many, many times, going camping, even the summer together.
I wish you the best of luck. Don't be a stranger. You know where to find me.
Just remember Canada. Montreal, and I will always remember jumping in the ocean right before I got married. Good luck, Ed, and you won't be a stranger for us.
Words to describe Eddie? Easy. Congenial.
Very determined.
Persistent.
A great friend.
Supportive.
Loyalty.
Considerate.
Selfless.
Caring.
Always determined.
Volatile.
A fast speed walker.
He is fast.
Passionate.
Passionate.
Understands what's right and what's wrong.
Dedicated.
Honesty.
Funny.
Very loyal.
Great role model.
Competitive.
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 Generous.
Always on the move.
Disciplined.
Driven.
Definitely caring.
Fast.
Want to support everyone as they overcome obstacles.
Loves kind of seeing people be happy.
Motivating.
Unflappable.
He always likes to live life.
Easygoing.
Inspiring.
Humor.
Persistent.
Definitely handsome.
I started coaching in the fall of 1986 in the middle school. I started teaching in 1985, and I didn't come right in and start coaching. I waited till next year. And I said, hey, any openings? And Matt didn't have an opening. So I started coaching middle school cross country because it was always my dream. I wanted to be a math teacher and a track coach. And at age 23, I did it. Favorite memories. I think one of my favorite memories is like when I was driving Katie home from Oneonta and live listening to the 4x8 last year and getting everyone split. You know, it was so exciting. I'm driving the car and I'm like, what happened? What did he run? You know, who's up next? And just in hearing all the splits and how exciting it was that we did so well and we qualified for Penn again. That was pretty amazing. Winning the county meet in cross country and going to the state meet for that frozen mud bath upstate last year was probably one of the highlights. Coaching Jack Rosenkranz was probably a very big, important part of my career. Going to the national meet twice with you was pretty cool. And just a lot of little things, you know, a lot of little races like Brady Wagner kicking ass last year and at the final stretch at Bethpage. You know, little things like that is things you remember, you know, or Andrew Girard, senior year, making all county, and just those kids who were there every single day who just came out of the woodwork and had an awesome day, and just remembering how happy they were and how happy I was. You know, just also just being that finally North Shore became like this, you know, this known quantity, you know, so proud of all the guys and team and who we were, you know, just we can go place and it'd be like, ah, it's North Shore. Or I remember a time I was at Glen Cove and this kid came up, talked to his coach, and he's like, Coach, North Shore's in our heat. And he was all upset because he knew he didn't have a chance of winning because we were in the same heat as they were in the relay. So that's pretty cool. Rodahan and Knight and those guys, yeah, I mean, they're like family to me. You know, it's, I met these guys. I've been here in high school for 12 years. I had pretty awesome friends in middle school. I got up here and I met these guys and they became kind of like some of the closest friends I've ever had in my life, so it's pretty cool. I'll dismiss really, you know, having people to talk to, even though I don't really talk to people all that much here in school. But I'll miss the guys in the office. I'll miss playing cards at lunch. I'll miss making fun of the hand. Yeah, every day.
You think you'll miss teaching high school? Or?
Yeah, man. I was like, my whole life, I kind of forget about that. The main reason I was here is to teach mathematics, and it was just kind of like something you did every day. And yeah, I'm going to miss sharing math. I'm going to miss talking about quadratic formula and product rule, things like that. Hope I don't forget it. I'll miss all the fun I had in the classroom. I loved having an audience every day. And just being funny and having a good time.
Which of the three seasons is your favorite?
Cross country, for sure.
Why?
First of all, I love the season. I love the time of year. The fall is great. I like the excitement of the cross country race and all the pressure being on one race and not 13 different individual activities and events. I also like the camaraderie with cross country. And yeah, it's more like a close brotherhood than it is a track and field. You don't have the distance guys and the sprinter guys. It's all just cross country.
Anything else you want to say?
No, just that I'm a lucky guy to have met as many wonderful teachers and kids I have had over these 34 years. And, you know, a lot of, to me, they're like celebrity names, you know. It's like, so like hearing, you know, someone famous. Well, if I mention a couple of track guys or students' names, to me, it's like hearing somebody who's a celebrity. And I'll always be excited to read about them and see how they're doing and maybe even bump into them somewhere in the world. So I think it's cool to have taught for 34 years and met so many people and have so many names in my head that I can't remember. But, you know, I had a great honor meeting a lot of great people.